Status report part 3. So this week I did some work on the Confined desktop, not quite as much as previously, but the things that I've done are pretty much visible to the human eye. So the basically in the previous weeks I did a lot of work for stuff behind the scenes, but now this week I basically tied a lot of loose ends and started confining some stuff that is actually accessible from the desktop and actually visible for a user. So let's have a look. Let's confirm that I'm enforcing first. So I'm logging in my restricted desktop environment. And let's just open the terminal to confirm that I am in enforcing mode before I make a fool out of myself. Get enforce. We're enforcing. So yeah, this is old stuff. You know, the terminal I confined and system monitor I confined. I already showed you that. The disk usage analyzer I confined. The files. Browser I confined, although there were some loose ends in my previous example, which I fixed in this example. Other stuff that I confined, the terminal obviously, and the system monitor. So let's have a look at stuff that I, oh yeah, and the file roller I showed you, there were some loose ends there as well, and the Nautilus browser, the Nautilus file viewer. So basically what I focused on this week was basically some other pretty mandatory stuff. For example, the Eye of GNOME, which is basically it's basically integrated into GNOME, so I had to do that just to make sure that that works in many cases. The password and keys manager, I had to do that to be able to confine the backup functionality, which works now. Might be some loose ends there as well, but I will get to that. And so other stuff that I confined was, oh yeah, the transmission program, which basically is a BitTorrent client. I confined that as well because, well, it's also tightly integrated into GNOME, so I had to take care of that as well. So now basically I'm at the point where the base, oh, and I confined gedit, where the base is confined. There are some loose ends. For example, the Nautilus send to functionality is basically a core component and is basically part of the base that I should have dealt with. But I can't deal with that because there are some dependencies there that are not met currently. So, for example, if I open my file browser and I'll say send to, then, and now it won't run because I'm in enforcing mode, but if you'll do that, then now we get an SELinux alert, obviously, but it allows you to send, for example, your file to the instant messenger, which is not confined yet, or send it over the network or stuff like that. But because those components are not yet confined, I decided to just skip that for now and just disable that functionality, so that I just need to basically take care of the dependencies before I can actually work on that. So that's not done yet. But anyway, so the files manager was confined previously, but there were some loose ends. So let's just do that first. Let's have a look at that first. So let's run the help program and basically print the help message of the help the help document, print it to the documents folder, I guess. Fine, print that, and so it's created in the documents folder, and now it's created without actually a lock. In the, if you noticed previously, there was a lock in the lower right corner that basically indicated that Nautilus was not having full access to it, and I fixed that now, so now it actually doesn't display the lock. But anyway, so I showed you that you can basically run it directly in events, so that works fine. But there was some issue with file roller. You couldn't actually run file roller directly from the file browser. So now that is dealt with. So I can basically compress that and just create that, and that works now. So it's just working. I can also basically extract that, no problem. Extract here, or I can basically move that. Let's see if I can create a new tab, and then just basically go home and then basically move that to the new tab, and now it's there, and now extract it here. So that works now, that functionality. I took care of that, and of course the thumbnails now also they were also displaying properly, and the recent functionality displays properly. And there was some issue though, by the way, in GNOME, where you basically can find files. So let's just look for output, and it finds it. But now if I run, for example, the output PDF straight from here, then I noticed that it wasn't actually, now it works nice, but, and it's also showing that there, but it seems that it's not always working properly, and that sometimes it takes a lot of time for it to actually do it. So let's try this one here. See, it does works fine. So I fixed that, I guess. Anyways, so that's basically the loose ends that I tied. So what I also did was the keys and authentication stuff. So basically when you run this program, you can generate your keys. That's a requisite for the backup functionality. So also let's have a look at home, and then just show all files so that you can show hidden files, so that you can actually, the problem with this program is that you can't actually, back in the days you could actually display a security context column, but they removed that, so I can't actually show you the security context from within the Nautilus file browser. But they can, for example, if I'm allowed to, at least I can, for example, do the properties and then view the security context from there. So here is the security context config home t type, but then I'll have to basically view the properties, and for this probably won't work because I don't have access to the SSH, and Nautilus doesn't have access to SSH, so doesn't see. It could not be determined. The permissions could not be determined because it doesn't have access to the to get the attributes of the SSH directory. But anyways, by just starting the passwords and keys program, some directories were created. Like for example, the SSH directory and the GNU PG directory was created, and that was created with proper private types automatically. Because if I go to the shell, yeah, and I probably won't be able to see it from a shell either, because I don't have access to that directly, and that's also neat because SSH, I do have access to that, which I should remove probably, because the user doesn't need access to SSH directly, I think. But GNU PG, I can't even access that, but you can be sure that it has a private type of the GNU GPG secret key type, so that's basically all nice and confined. But anyway, so I can create a key, or fine. So let's just create a key because I'm going to need it. Secure shell key, and then I'll just call that my login user advert, and then just create it. I haven't supported the create and setup functionality yet, but I might at some point do that. And I was just creating the key. I'll enter a passphrase, ABC123, keep it simple. This is just for demonstration, ABC123. Okay, and now the key is created. The key is in the SSH directory, so it's basically classified by default. So here it is, it's created by this program, and it has the private type SSH home T. So that's all fine and restricted by default. I can actually read this from a shell probably. So if I get that then it should, yeah. So I can actually read that, but I probably won't, yeah, and I'm actually probably will be able to actually manage that, so I could actually manually edit it, this, and I want to basically remove the functionality. But anyways, I also did the GPG stuff, because that's also needed by the backup functionality, so I also focus on that, so create a GPG key. So actually, what this does is it runs GPG in the background, and I confine GPG as well. So if I look, for example, I'll just use a shell to view that. And I can just do ps aux because it only shows my processes anyways. Then you can, it's currently not running GPG yet because I am not doing anything yet, but Seahorse is confined, as you can see here, with a separate private type, all these GVFSD components. But anyways, it runs GPG in the background. You can count on that. And so full name, my login user is its surname, and then my login user at test Iranian command test, and then advanced key options. I can just do that. So it's all, of course, 4096. We want some decent key strength, and never expires. Create it, and the help functionality works. So you can basically so this is basically the GNOME help functionality in the background. So that's confined and accessible by Seahorse. So that's important. And then you can enter your passphrase again. So ABC123, and then okay that. And now it's creating that on. It needs some entropy, because else it's gonna take a long time. So I'm give it some entropy there. Come on. Yeah, but strong key, so that strong key also requires me to give it a lot of entropy. It takes a long time. But anyways, I just want to demonstrate that. But anyways, in the meanwhile, I can basically take care of setting up that key, so that for the next example, for the backup functionality. So now I'm root here on TTI 0, so I need to basically ls home. I need to basically add my key home, my login user SSH, cuts home SSH, and then it's basically the pub file, pub. And then basically append that to my home Dominic SSH authorized key. And that should append that. Let's have a look. Till and one, and there it is, my login user at first. So took care of that. So I can basically go back now to my main screen here, and it's still generating the key. Come on, give me a break. I could basically find permission denied, yeah, of course. So yeah, that everything is denied, so it can't actually do anything. So I can't actually speed up that either, but I can only do this for entropy and not use the find command. Oh, there we have it. So it's done. So now we have actually a GPG key, so that this all works. So users can create a GPG key and a SSH key, but basically this was a prerequisite for the backup functionality. So let's just say we have a file and document, so let's backup documents. Now let's open the backup program, backup, And then just show my backup settings. Let's set that up. So folders, let's remove this folder here and let's add a folder, and this all seems to work fine. And I'll just add this documents folder. Open that. So now I'm just saying backup my documents folder, and then I'll use the storage. I only supported SSH for now, so just so you know, the other Windows shares and stuff is not supported currently. So yeah, SSH, and then the server is SSH net kb info, and the port is 22, and then the directory is home Dominic. I'm going to back up to my other, it's basically the same system, other user account, just to show you that. And then the login name is Dominic, and this is set up now. So this should basically in theory work, unless I overlook something. So I can use the help functionality also from the backup program. So yeah, it seems obvious to you, but you basically need to explicitly allow everything that it does. So I had to explicitly tell SE Linux, okay, when the backup program runs on my behalf, then allow it to run the backup program on my behalf, to run the Yelp program on my behalf. So I had to actually allow everything explicitly. So backup now, verify, and then the password, which is ABC123, and then automatically allow that, put that into my key ring. And then basically you see it below here, it's connected to SSH. And then basically here you have your encryption password, ABC123, ABC123, and also allow add that to your to my key ring, and then continue, password protect. And now I basically have to unlock my GPG key as well, which basically is already entered. Remember the password also. Continue. And now it's scanning, doing its thing, and uploading to the remote server, and verifying the backup, and that's almost done. So now that's basically done. So now I can basically run here and say revert to previous version. But let's have a look at the keys functionality first. So where is that? Oh, did I close that? I guess I did. So let's reopen the keys. And now you can see that it also added my tokens for the backup encryption password and the so that it was all allowed. That's basically under the hood, where basically the backup program debus chats to the GNOME keyring daemon, and to basically asks it to store those credentials in the keyring. And all these components are confined, so you can basically if you want to make that those rules conditional and say, okay, this user cannot add his backup credentials to the key ring, but some other program can. Yeah, that might be actually useful if you don't, if you want to enforce on your users that they don't store their passwords in the GNOME key ring. Then you can basically disallow this access, and then it won't be allowed. Just for encrypted devices, it's a bad idea to basically store it in your key ring, I think. I never store my passphrases for encrypted devices in the devices in my key ring. I don't like that at all. I want to basically manually type that in. I don't want that password on that system at all. So we could disallow that. But anyway, so the backup functionality works. Now I can basically from the file browser basically refer to a previous version. So that basically runs it, restore from where, and it can just tell it to restore from there, and then it just basically backup from when. That's fine. Forward, and then restore, and now the stuff is restored. So that works naturally, although it's still very limited with regards to which backup options you can choose. So it doesn't work from Samba, doesn't work from cloud. It only works with SSH because that's how I use it. But the basics are that. And now also another thing. Now I can actually browse my Dominic directory remote directly from Nautilus. So I can here actually see the backup. This is actually the backup on the remote system. So yeah, that actually works. And yeah, other functionality, like for example, I already showed you that the trash works, which is basically also that's the DVFSD trash component that actually takes care of that. And so from the file manager perspective, almost everything works except the send to functionality, and also the make link functionality doesn't work. She cannot create a link. That's just an easy rule that I need to that I can add, but I haven't done it yet. But yeah, so there are some loose ends there still. Bookmark that location should work, so I can yeah, and it's already bookmarked, so that doesn't make sense, but that functionality all works fine. So yeah, the file browser now is pretty. Yeah, it works pretty decent. Although there are probably also some loose ends. But anyways, you can see you're in your home directory, but there's just still some stuff that you can't access. Like for example, you can't even open your bash RC file. But you can basically, let's have a look at that. Let's look at home, and then there's this template directory. And now I can create a folder here, which is all allowed, I guess. And then create test, and inside here I can create a file if all is well. New document, and then just create an empty document. My test text, and now I can basically open this directly in gedit. I confine gedit as well, so I can basically just open that and save that. And now I can basically, now if you look in there and you open it with the edit, then it's edited. Looks simple, but there's a lot of stuff going on there. So let's create a new file, another test, and then save as. So and the print preview works, but this is not actually an events that does this print preview. This is some built-in functionality somehow. The print functionality works. At least I tried. So print a file. It's actually PDF, so now it's actually printing the PDF, and it seems to work just fine. And save this file. Oh, this is actually close preview, and this is ex save this file, save as, and then save that somewhere else. For example, just in my home directory, and then just another test text and save that. And it actually works, so that's fine, that's nice. And here is another test, and then I could open that again, and then you'll see that another test is in there. So yeah, the basic functionality works. You can browse the file system from here, all fine. And then show hidden files. So a lot of stuff. For example, bash profile probably won't. Well, actually, you might actually be able to read that, but not edit it. So open the ba let's open the bash RC file. See if it opens. It opens, but let's try now to save something, just to add something. Test, and then save. But there is no save functionality because it knows, and that's what it says here: read only. So it knows it can't edit it. So you can't actually use the bash RC file to edit your own bash RC. You can't use gedit to edit your own bash RC file. And that's basically, I did that on purpose. If you want to edit it, just use the shell to edit it, and not from the gedit stop. So yeah, that I took care of that as well. Let's also have a look at some other functionality I took care of. For example, the Eye of GNOME. So you can basically use this to open an image. So where there's an image in user share backgrounds, so file, you can browse the file system in to some extent. You can, for example, browse var, I guess, access is denied, but you can browse user share because yeah, all these programs need access to user share because that's readable content that they need. So user share. And then backgrounds, and then images, and then just open some image, open that, and then basically you can save that to your home directory if you'd like. So save that to my login user, yeah, save that there, and now it should be in my file. Here it is, the thumbnail is created nice, and now I can actually use this to set as a background, set as wallpaper. And that functionality also works, and this is basically G-Settings doing that stuff. So, but I can't open it with Shotwell. So if I'd like, Shotwell is not confined, and anything that is not confined doesn't work. So, doesn't work. Now it doesn't even give me a nice error message, which sucks. But it doesn't work either. Anyway, so set as wallpaper, and now my wallpaper is changed. And well, it seems simple to you, but in the background there's a lot of stuff going on, because actually this stuff sends it to here, it copies the file to wallpapers, so now the file is here as well. So in the background, it actually some component actually, and that's probably G-Settings or GNOME Shell itself, I'm not sure, I forgot. But anyway, something is copying this file into the pictures and then that's a wallpapers folder. And also in the cache wallpaper folder, which you can't access, see, you can't access directly, but there's also a copy in there. And then G-Settings basically changes the wallpaper for you on the background. But that functionality is all supported, so that's cool, because yeah, that's not very sensitive security-wise, so that should be working, and that works. So yeah. And I can basically just throw away some files. So another test, if I want to throw that away, that's fine. Move trash, works fine. And now it's in trash, and I can just empty that. And that works fine. So yeah, those are the things that I focused on last week. Oh, and the file, the archive manager works, but I already showed you that. Backup. Gedit, disk usage analyzer, document viewer, files works, Gedit works, image viewer works, passwords and keys works, and then system monitor works, and oh yeah, transmission. So let's have a look. So for example, let's get some BitTorrent from Fedora. So I have this Fedora bookmark here, Fedora project, and then you can basically download, and then there's all download methods, and then use a simple BitTorrent, for example, the live image here, and copy link location, see if that works, because that didn't work the last time I tried it, and then basically open transmission. It basically automatically pastes in, so that's working. So that's that URL for that torrent. So open that and just get it, and that works. So that's neat. This is all protected, by the way. This is all confined, so basically it can connect to any unprivileged port, and can connect to HTTPD, because that torrent file is actually in on a web server. And then in the background, let's have a look what it shows when I ps out. So you have here actually transmission GTK, which is the transmission process, and then you have GVSD HTTPD, which is spawned by transmission. So that actually gets the URL, I guess, or yeah, gets the torrent from that Fedora site, and then transmission, and this probably won't work. That's that. No, you can't actually get that stuff, and yeah, that's probably also a good thing. The shell is pretty much confined, the user in the shell is pretty much confined, so we can't actually see what's going on there. But anyway, so that works, and it's basically downloading with, well, about 30 megabits, I guess. So that should be done soon. And then we can have a look at that. But there's some loose ends here as well, because now I basically allowed it to download everything, and that's basically a dir with stuff in there. But if I only chose one file, then that probably wouldn't work, because I haven't defined a file type transition for single files, only for a directory. So basically, when GTK transmission GTK creates a directory in the user home directory, it automatically file type transitions from the user home data type to the user home content type. But that's only specified for dirs, and so if it tries to instead create a file instead of a dir in a user home dir, then there's no the file type transition defined, so then it will try to create that file with the user home directory type, which is not allowed, and then shit hits the fan. A lot of loose ends, a lot of testing involved, and all kinds of scenarios, and yeah, well, it's basically basically optimization work, so to speak. That's basically, you'll have to, you need a few testers who actually test it and then report bugs that are in there, and then this quickly fix those bugs. But the basic functionality works. If you, for me, in this example, it works. So yeah, let's just we're going to need this. But a lot of stuff doesn't work yet, obviously. So Firefox still gets a failed message, failed to launch. And a lot of other stuff as well. Network settings, failed to launch. Anything that is not confined is just not allowed. It's just not allowed to run it. And yeah, there's still some AVC denials. I should basically hide them. So for example, no solitaire for you. So that's basically what I done this week. I wasn't so as productive as last week, and but I now at this point I can basically say, okay, now I have the base in place. Now I have the base functionality in place, and now I can basically just work on other stuff. So I'm probably going to work on the requirements for the Nautilus Send To functionality. So I probably want to confine the instant messenger so that Nautilus Send To can actually send a file to the with to instant messenger, and so that I can basically offer a file in my instant messenger. And since instant messenger is still also a thing, so the sound also works fine. And then open folder, so see if this works. Yeah, this works obviously, because that's basically just GNOME shell running Nautilus, and then you have it here. So basically, this is what I'm saying. Oh, it's actually creating that dir in the downloads dir, so it's not the home user home dir type, but the user home content type. So, but it actually created dir in there, and then the file. And so, open this file with disk image mounter. It's not going to happen. Archive manager, that works. See, that works fine, but not with the mounter. That's not going to work. Gedit works, so I can actually open this checksum with the edit. So yeah, that's pretty nice stuff. But basically, as you can see, the user doesn't have to do anything to think about security, really. At least I'm also, of course, I also know how it behaves, so it's not quite fair. But I think that if someone who doesn't even know SE Linux and sits behind the system and does know a little bit about GNOME and how that stuff works, that he should probably be able pretty much of his stuff without actually realizing that there's plenty of security going on behind the scenes. And that's the basic idea. You just want the user to focus on his productivity and not be bothered with security, at least as little as possible. Even a user needs to be security aware. That's just it. I'm uploading with 2K. That's not much. But as little as possible, and that works, because if he does something that he shouldn't be able to do, like for example documents, then you get denied permission, and then he knows, okay, I'm not supposed to do that. So that's basically it, but there's ABC denials which suck. And I want to basically remove those as well. Basically make sure that whatever the user does, no ABC denials pop up. But that's still a work in progress. So yeah, with that said, I think I'll leave you take one more look at I might have overlooked something. I think I had it all documented. I showed you the document viewer. Empathy. I want to work on empathy. I like that. Remote desktop, obviously, and XJet, obviously. I don't have Office installed. Dictionary should be nice to also confine that, because it's actually you can actually make it connect to the dictionary server. And of course your mailer would be nice to confine. It's also a pretty complex mail user agent, so there's a lot of work involved, but we have the base in place now for GNOME, so anything we confine now should integrate neatly. And Eclipse, we should confine that as well, also pretty interesting. Pretero, of course your music and your videos and your webcam, although there is no webcam in this virtual machine, so that doesn't really make sense. Software, we don't want to allow that, of course, and virtual machine, we don't want to allow that. We might want to allow GNOME boxes, firewall, and these are all basically most of these programs are basically privileged. For example, firewall management is privileged, but we can actually use role-based access control. We can basically implement that inside the desktop without actually knowing that the user changes its role-based access control properties. So we can basically tell SE Linux, okay, when my login user runs the firewall program, then role transition from one role to another, to a privileged role, and domain transition from the shell domain, because it's run from the shell, to a privileged domain. And then basically he can actually run the firewall program, but in a restricted environment. So it can only use the firewall program in the way that the firewall program is meant to be used. And then we should also probably add some support for authentication, because if you run that, then you'll get your policy kit dialog, which basically pops up and wants the root password, it doesn't want the root password if you basically allow that put that user into a group, like for example Wheel. If you put it in the Wheel group, then it just asks the user for its own password. So we could allow that, because as Linux, basically, although you have access to the Wheel group, you're still restricted. So you can basically be confident that the Wheel group cannot be abused, because as Linux is sitting on a layer below the traditional Linux security, basically overriding a traditional Linux security. So you can basically be confident that the Wheel group can only be used in the way that you want it to be used. So that's nice as well. Okay, yeah, I can talk hours for this, so I'm just going to close the programs out. And actually, I'll just clear the main desktop. Clear at least these files here. Move to trash. Empty trash. And then I'll close this down. Quit. And close the shell. And remove this. Delete files and remove. Works. See, that's all just working fine. Close the connection. And then just log off. Oh, and there's another ABC denial there on the dismiss. I can't view it anyways. Log out. So yeah, nice stuff. And we're getting somewhere. It's really now it's all falling into place, and you really have some functionality in there. It's really getting useful now. So yeah, that's neat. So that's basically concludes my third status report. Basically the third or fourth week. I'm now entering probably the fourth week in this project, but I'm basically losing interest now, because I've done the hardest part. I basically took care of the base, so the challenge is a little bit gone. Now it's just basically confining applications, which is basically easy compared to basically designing the base. That's basically a challenge, and that challenge is basically now achieved. Although there are some challenges to address, for example, like running privileged applications inside the GNOME shell, which is also a challenge. So I might actually that might give me a drive to proceed. But yeah, next week I'll probably do the instant messenger and maybe some other components that I'd like that are interesting. But hopefully I won't slow down too much, because, well, I got this far, and so it might be a good idea to just follow through. So yeah, with that said, goodbye.